Welcome to another episode of Eric Waite Whiskey Studies, and this is the first episode of a 17-part series on the history of Scotch whiskey. Since I'm launching this on June 1st, which is Ardbeg Day, I thought I would pour myself a little bit of the Ardbeg Drum Committee release, which I have already reviewed. So this is essentially like a class on Scotch whiskey history, and I think it will greatly improve or enhance your appreciation for Scotch whiskey, as well as give you a better understanding of how economics, production, the relationship between the state, the government, the people, how war, economics, everything else impacts whiskey, the regulations, why it can and cannot be sold on particular times and places, and so forth. History is the why behind whiskey and in the way it's made. So it's really, really important, I think, if you want to have a really full understanding of whiskey, to get into the history of Scotch whiskey. The perfect textbook for this is The Science and Commerce of Whiskey by Ian Buxton and Paul Hughes, particularly Chapter 2. And if you happen to be studying for the Diploma in Single Malt Scotch at the Edinburgh Whiskey Academy, as I will be at the end of this series, then this video series is going to be really helpful to you. So pour yourself a glass of whatever you got and tune in with me as we, in small bite-sized pieces, go through the history of Scotch malt whiskey. All right, the discovery of the art of distillation is one of mankind's great achievements, leading to the transformation of grape, grain, sugar, and other potable vegetables, such as potatoes, into brandy, vodka, gin, rum, and whiskey. Of these, whiskey is arguably the most diverse and fascinating, with an extraordinary heritage and remarkable present-day status. Although distillation is documented by the Greeks, Egyptians, and Arabs, a strong case can be made for the Chinese as the first distillers, probably using barley and rye. From China, the mysterious art is believed to have traveled to Arabia. And by the 10th century, the Spanish-Arabian physicist Abulcasis had written extensively on the distillation of vinegar, water, and wine. Get a little parched, so let's take a wee sip. Smoky, and fruity. Let's continue. The Arabians are credited with the innovation of the cooling tube, leading from the still head with water, and the Greeks were also distilling at quite an early age. Aristotle, who lived from around 384 to 322 BC, wrote about the chemistry of distillation. While the Egyptians were practicing the craft during the time of Diocletian, around 285 to 305 AD. However, it is thought that knowledge of the distillation of alcohol did not reach Europe until the 11th or 12th century, being passed on by the Moors or by soldiers returning to Britain from the Crusades. The first surviving written record of Scotch whiskey occurs in 1494. That date is easy to remember because it's 2 years after Christopher Columbus sailed the ocean blue. Cora was a friar at the Benedictine Order's Lindores Abbey in Fife, in Scotland. It seems likely, however, that distilling was taking place in Scotland for some considerable time prior to that notable date, as 8 bulls is the equivalent of around a half a ton, so the friar was distilling on quite a considerable scale. It may be that this large order was to be used as a regent for igniting gunpowder and cannon, which fascinated King James IV. And let us take another wee sip. Mmm. The Irish claim to have been making whiskey long before the Scots, with some authors confidently stating that soon after King Henry II's invasion of Ireland in 1170, the inhabitants of the country were found to be drinking this spirit. It's also asserted that Sir Thomas Savage gave his troops ushkabe in 1276 prior to going into battle against the English. However, closer examination of the facts reveals that this was actually a drink made from wine rather than grain. What can be stated with certainty is that during the 14th century, Irish monks used distillation to produce medical remedies, and when King Elizabeth I came to the throne in 1558, whiskey drinking was widespread in Ireland. It is sometimes claimed that the art of whiskey distillation spread from Ireland to Scotland via the Hebrides and the remote Kintyre Peninsula. One of the reasons for drinking spirits in wet mountainous country is that it is difficult to grow hops, the essential preservative in beer, and spirits are much easier to transport than beer. So already I've used the word ushkabe, which is a Gaelic term. We need to define or better understand this word. The word whiskey comes from the Gaelic word ushkabe or ushkaba, itself a translation from aqua vitae, the Latin for water of life. Progressive Anglicization occurred from the early 17th century, from usque around 1618 to whiskey in 1715. The first attestation, the modern Scots spelling, occurs in 1746. The spelling differs between Scotland and Ireland, where it is spelled with an E as whiskey. This came to describe grain as opposed to malt whiskey. Rather confusingly, a good deal of Irish whiskey was until the end of the 19th century made in Scotland and sold as such. So cheers to the Irish, the Scots, whoever first came up with whiskey. Whoever made it first, the Scots certainly took to distilling whiskey with great enthusiasm, and in 1579, the Scottish Parliament banned the use of grain for distilling purposes for a year due to a serious crop failure, suggesting that the practice was clearly widespread by that time. In 1644, a duty was imposed on whiskey for the first time. It was not to be the last. Much of the history of Scotch whiskey is sort of a battle between the exchequer or the taxman and the whiskey producer. Given Scotland's unpredictable climate, crop failures were common, and it was both difficult and expensive to import grain until the 19th century. From this point onwards, right up to the present day, the history of Scotch whiskey has been inextricably linked to legislation aimed at maximizing government revenue from the trade. It should also be noted that as soon as duty was imposed on whiskey making, someone, somewhere, decided to make whiskey and not pay duty. And the history of illicit distilling ran parallel to that of legal distilling for more than two centuries after the imposition of duty in 1644. Now, there's two things you're not supposed to talk about in polite company. One is politics, and the other is religion. But as we're going to find out, these are two topics really intertwined in the history of whiskey, so it's quite unavoidable. The Act of Union of 1707 decreed that the same levels of duty should be levied on both sides of the border between Scotland and England, and in 1713 the malt tax was extended from England into Scotland, albeit at half the English rate. In 1725, the tax was increased for a bushel of malt, and civil unrest culminated in Glasgow's Schofield riots during the June of that year, when the mansion belonging to the pro-malt tax member of Parliament, Daniel Campbell, was ransacked. With the £9,000 compensation he received, Campbell bought the Hebridean island of Islay, and in years to come, the Campbell family would do much to nurture legal distillation on Islay, which ultimately came to be recognized by the Scotch Whisky Association as a whisky-producing region in its own right, with a full smoky and medicinal signature character, just like this Ardbeg drum. One of the result of a malt tax was a reduction across Scotland in the consumption of ale and the growth of brandy and whisky sales, which led to the trebling of whisky production in Scotland during 1725 and 1726. This increase came at a price, however, in order to minimize the amount of malt tax which had to be paid. Legal distillers used as little malted barley as was feasible, with a high percentage of raw grain and sometimes other potable vegetables. Some malt was to be incorporated into any mash to produce the diacetes, essential for fermentation. Consequently, illicitly distilled whiskey from the Scottish Highlands was often of far better quality.
Can we please get some alcohol into my mouth?
Alrighty, so that's it for our first lesson. In our next video, we're going to get into the expansion and legislation of Scotch whisky. We've got sort of a lot of ground to cover, but I'm going to do everything in small little portions. And hopefully, perhaps you're taking notes along the way, because I want to do a quiz at the end of this 17-part series. Alrighty, if you subscribe to this channel, I want to thank you very much. If you haven't yet subscribed, but you like watching my videos, I would greatly appreciate it if you would subscribe. Give this a thumbs up. Share with your friends on Facebook, Twitter, and other social networking channels. And be sure to join me next time as we continue our study of Scotch whisky history. And until then, cheers.